when people have a conversation, whether it's in a pub, wherever it is, and people talk about gambling, the first thing that comes to their head of, I've done a violent passive. So it's not just about the money. There's so many issues that go along with the finance side of it. As you can see here, I know you guys have had some talks on drugs and alcohol. We deal with drugs and alcohol agencies in terms of rehab centres where we do our talks to their clients, because obviously a lot of the guys and girls that have had drug addiction or have addiction stem initially from gambling addiction. So it's all about the coping mechanism, it's all about that having that multi-addiction. So with gambling, for instance, you can imagine when you're in serious debt and your head's messed up, you might just turn to drugs just to cope with it, you might start drinking. So it's all linked. Yeah, it's all linked. So that's one of the things. Crime is something I'm happy to admit that I've committed by crime throughout the depths of my addiction. As I said to you earlier before, you will do anything, absolutely anything, to get yourself out of debt, to save your house, to save your apartment, whatever the case may be. You get to a point where there's a crossroads. You know, some people go over it, some people don't. But crime is massive. We've spoken to prisons in terms of the people that are inside there because they've committed crime through their gambling addiction. They've created debts and people are chasing them for money. So crime is massive when it comes to gambling addiction, the impact of gambling addiction. Loss of employment, as I said earlier, for you students, whether your performances drop, because you've got a bit of gambling and you can't handle it, and you fail to turn to lessons. And the same with the university students, they drop out, having blown all their student loans. So that's important. Health, I think you've had talks with mental health. Have you had talks with mental health practitioners? Yeah, so mental health is massive. We touched on it earlier in terms of the suicide and the case studies you see. With me, I had depression, I had panic attacks, anxiety attacks, couldn't cope, again, failed to turn up to training, etc., playing sick, all the rest of it, but mentally it affects you hugely. And I'm just so fortunate, I would say fortunate, to get to the point where I've crossed that line between having depression and acute depression, whereby you may just go over the line and think there's no hope, there's no way forward, that's the end of the line, I'm never going to get this death back. Fell out with everybody, no one's been, etc., etc., and then you think that's the end, you know, it's all over for me. And that's a real sad and dark place to be. So the health side of it is important. We talked earlier about the teachers, parents, etc., and managers. One of those things there about the mood swings where I said to you about people coming into work one day or coming into class one day and they're completely different to how they normally are. You just got to ask the question, basically. That's the my advice on that. Ask the question, you never know, they might just bring it out. As I said, we were withdrawn and deprivation, that's massive. Relationships, that's another one. As I said to you, these seven elements, you know, you look at them all. If I had to say one that probably applies to me more than anything, I would say the relationships. I had a 20-year relationship, which broke down 7 years ago. So we can talk about the money, we can talk about the cars and the cars, etc. But for me, the relationship is probably the biggest loss. Yeah, that's my biggest loss in my opinion. Divorce rates have gone through the roof in terms of husbands or wives not knowing about what their partners are up to. There's only so much someone can take when you're burdened with their problems, especially when it comes to financial issues. And my ex-partner, by the end, she'd had enough and I'd let her down so many times. We talk about the lies and the deceit that comes out, and that happens a lot, especially in relationships. Eventually, I lost my partner, and that's something, you know, money can be replaced, possessions can be replaced, but unfortunately, that was the end of my relationship. So I would say that was the biggest loss for me. So when it comes to relationships, you know, you will hide things from your partner, you know, especially when the bailiffs come knocking, the repossession letters come, you know, you're going to hide it from your husband or hide it from your wife. And as I said, it's all lies and it's all deceit, and that's what comes down, that's what follows. So we've got to appreciate the dangers of broken relationships and friendships. I've lost friends along the way, and you will lose friends along the way, because there will come a time where your friends will stop picking up the phone, because they know what's coming. It's another £20, it's another £50, oh, you still have another £50. Yeah, that time will come and you will lose good friends, you know, friends that have been there along the way, eventually you'll lose them. You'll fall out with people, you'll fall out with family members. I've got a big family, fortunate for me, I had a lot of support, but there were times when I fell out with one or two of my brothers. We talk about it now in terms of, you know, the days when they used to ring up and say, oh, not, you know, say, not again, not again, not again. But fortunately for me, they stuck by me, you know, to the recovery, but not all siblings will stick by each other. You know, you will have broken relationships and family members you will fall out with. Homelessness, yet another big one. I've had two houses repossessed. And when you talk about the two houses repossessed, that's probably, yes, I'd say the second biggest thing in terms of the elements. Homeless, some people obviously are lucky enough to have a good family or might have good friends that can put them off. You'll be fortunate for that. But when you get that repossession layout or that eviction notice, you know what's coming. You know the date, and if you can't, if you haven't got friends, or you haven't got a big family, and you've got nowhere to go, then you will end up on the streets. And you've got thousands and thousands and thousands of gambling addicts that have ended up on the streets. So repossession is huge. Cultural, there are different cultures in here today. When we talk about the cultural side of it, there are certain countries where gambling is forbidden. But unfortunately, when they come to the UK and they get involved in the advertising and promotion of gambling, which is in your face, it's on the airwaves, it's on the TV screen, in the press, then they will get enticed and get encouraged to gamble, regardless of their faith, regardless of their religion. So that's another thing that we look at. And moving on, acknowledgement. This was a big thing for me when I talk about talking to people and talking, whether it's my managers, whether it's my parents, whether it's my friends. It's very, very difficult to come out of denial. That's probably the hardest thing. I'm here talking to you guys. I talk to lots of other people about my journey and where I've been. But it took me a long, long time to come out of denial. Based in 2010 was when it started, when I started travel counselling. And you do have to have counsel, you do have to get professional help. But the first step is to hold your hands up and acknowledge that you've got a problem. And that's the hardest thing, because you just continue in denial. And that's what I've done for years and years and years, just racked up the debt. I'll give you an example of when we talk about how far it took me. Does anybody know what bankruptcy is? Yeah? Right, bankruptcy. This is what happened to me in 2010. This is a bankruptcy file. So when you get into thousands and thousands of pounds of debt, there are certain things you can do. It doesn't apply to everybody, there's certain criteria, etc. It doesn't apply to everybody. But it is a way to start again for some people. In 2010, this is a £192,000 bankruptcy file. This has 32 creditors in, from payday loans to credit cards to loans to pawnbrokers to absolutely everybody, every creditor out there. And I racked up my debts with all these people by borrowing, until eventually I dug myself a hole that I was never ever going to get out of. There's no way of me paying back £200,000. My football career finished, 32. So at the end of the day, there was no way else for me to go in terms of what I'm going to do future-wise. So I had counselling, which I said earlier, you have to have counselling, you have to have professional help. And part of that professional help was looking at what I can do going forward, you know, in terms of hope, in terms of rebuilding my life. Yeah, it takes a lot of strength and character to do it, but you've got to really want to do it. You've actually got to really want to move on. So I did my £192,000 bankruptcy file and became bankrupt in 2010. The main stipulation with it, for those of you who don't know, is that it stays on your credit card for 6 years and you can't get any credit whatsoever. And to me, that was me saying to myself, you know what? I've cleared my £109,000 debt and I don't want any more credit. I don't want any loans. I don't want no credit cards. I don't want anything. So, but you've got to have that mindset. You've got to be real with yourself. And you've got to say, okay, clean slate. I can start to build my life again now. And that's what I've done. And as I said, from 2011 onwards, better life, stress-free, mentally stable, healthy, happy, financially stable. And as I said at the bottom there, you've got to want to change. You know, sorry. But continue, long-term therapy, we'll come to that in a minute. But from 2011, as I said, to 2014, I wrote the book, Red Card, and that was another part of my recovery, to basically get the message out there, not just for my friends and family, but for everybody. So Red Card is the start of the Red Card project. It's from red card to book, came red card down the sport budget. So it's a good recovery for me. As we say there, the road to recovery, it takes time. As I said, you've really got to want to do it. And that means if you've got friends or you've got family members, mum or dad, brother or sister, you know, and you feel or you may know that they've got an issue with gambling, just talk to them and encourage them to get help. You have to talk to them and get them to acknowledge that they've got an issue, yeah? Therapy is not short term. So when you are in a position, or family members or friends are in a position where they're going to go for therapy, it is long term. You're not going to get cured or you're not going to sort your life out within 2 or 3 weeks. So you have to be committed. Red card of addiction therapist, which you can contact. We'll talk about that later in terms of the issues you've got. You can call us anytime, confidentially, whether it's a friend or family. But you have to remember it's long term. It's generally months and months of therapy to get yourself to a position where you can move on. And also, mainly, is to get to the root of the problem. The root cause, which is why a lot of us don't understand, and I don't still fully understand what the root cause of my addiction. You can go back to lots of different things in terms of childhood, trauma, lots of many issues. So therapy, very important to move on. Length of therapy, impact of therapy. Estimated that gambling addicts will have severely affected the lives of at least 15 of their friends and family, and employers are set to always support their gambling. That's the Board of Movie Association. They're a rehab centre, a residential rehab centre who we work with. So when I talk about gambling affecting other people, we're talking about family members, talking about friends, as it says in there, employers. So you're not just letting yourself down, you're letting the workplace down, your manager, you're letting, in my case, my football manager, or letting your supporters down, because you've come onto the pitch with my head all over the place, you may have to say you're playing with 10 men. So you're letting so many people down, and that's why that stat is there. We have to think of the bigger picture. It's not just about you. You're burning your family, you're burning your friends with issues that are your issues and for you to deal with. So it's not fair to be going to family members and friends asking for money left, right, centre to feed your habit. So that's something very important to remember.